الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وصلوات الله وسلامه على أفضل خلق الله سيدنا وحبيبنا رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد فقد قال جل وعلا في كتابه المجيد بعد أن أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا وجاء في الحديث النبوي أنه عليه الصلاة والسلام قال ما يقعد قوم يذكرون الله تعالى إلا حفت بهم الملائكة وغشيتهم الرحمة وذكرهم الله في من عنده أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Before I begin, there's one thing that I would like to state, and that is that there's a sunnah of one of the great ulama, someone that I admire, and someone that every one of us owes quite a bit to. His name is Mawlana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullah Alayh, Hakim al-Ummah wa Mujaddid al-Millah. For many of us who are from the subcontinent, we don't really know, but this individual is probably responsible for a lot of our reformation, of our deen. So one thing that he would state is that any time that I would have to present an exposition or address a crowd, I would think to myself that how unworthy I am to do that. And if I say something which I have no right to speak about, then what effect will it have? But then he said that I would continue thinking about the matter, and then I would realize that if it's something that I lack, I should speak about it. It's just so much more deserving that I speak about it, because then I truly become the first amongst the audience. So today I follow his sunnah. Allah Azza wa Jal in Surah Ali Imran refers to a group of individuals that he calls the intellectuals. He says about them, the quality of theirs is that they reflect over the heavens. He says that if you look at the heavens and the cosmos, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. He refers to the cosmos, the skies and the heavens, the skies, the earth, and everything between them as ayat, as signs. A sign is something that signifies something else. So if you see a stop sign, that means stop. When you see a red light, that means stop. When you see a green light, that means go. It's telling you something. So the cosmos, Allah Azza wa Jalla says that they tell us something. They're a sign. But for who? For those who have potential, for those who have a core, for those who have intellect. بِآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. But then he goes on and he defines who those people are, the people of intellect, the people with a core, the people with potential. And he says that these people are those that recollect. الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهِ. Those who remember Allah. قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ. While they stand, while they sit, and while they lie on their sides, and they lay on their sides. These are the people of intellect. الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَىٰ جُنُوبِهِمْ. They do this often. They recollect. Dhikr means to recall something that you already know. Allah Azza wa Jal refers to a scenario that happened long before time even can really be put, can be stipulated, where he says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that recite to them the incident when Allah extracted Bani Adam, the dhurriyah of Bani Adam, wa ashhadahum ala anfusihim alastu bi rabbikum, and he made them bear witness that am I not your Lord. So this is something that we already know. For every one of us responded by saying, Bala shahidana. We had witnessed the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal. And when we came into this world, we had that ilm as well. فطرت الله التي فطر الناس عليها. Allah speaks the truth. It's a fitra, it's a natural disposition that we have, that Allah has created us to know who He is. But what happens is that as time progresses and situations arise, we forget this knowledge that we already have innately and inherently. So we have to remember. We have to learn so that we can remember. Allah says those people of intellect are those who remember what they already know. And they do it often. They do it while they're sitting. They do it while they're standing. They do it while they're lying on their sides. And when that process takes place, a type of cleansing takes place as well. And when this cleansing manifests, then there's a new element that develops in a person, and that's called meditation and tafakkur. The ability to look at something and come to know what you don't know. It's to put things that you know to come to know what you don't know. وَيْتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. As the process continues of dhikr, what happens is that there's a cleansing. And the cleansing of the heart takes place, and the place of meditation and the place of thought is the heart. Now the people can look at the cosmos and say, مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا. You have not created this out of vain. It has meaning. Everything has meaning. These are the people who recollect, and these are the people of intellect. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا. Oh, those who believe, remember Allah abundantly. Hakim al-Ummah, Hazrat Hani rahmatullahi alayhi, notes a very interesting fact here. He says that if you look at the Sharia, there are two different types of ibadah. You have one form of ibadah, which there's some form of stipulation, that you should not go beyond the i'tidal, you should not go beyond what is normal and balanced. And he gives the example of salah. We have the famous incident of Mi'raj, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ascended, and he had 50 salah that he came down with, that he was about to come down with, and that cut down to five. Five and five only. This is what is necessary. So five salah are necessary. Yes, you can add more, but there are certain times throughout the day which you can't pray. After Fajr Salah, you cannot pray until the sun rises. You can't perform Salah at zenith, at midday. It's haram. You can't perform Salah while the sun rises or sun sets. It's haram. So Salah, there's a form of i'tidal there. When you have wealth, you can spend wealth. There's no doubt about that. But there's a type of wealth that if you continue to spend, it becomes makruh. It becomes impermissible. Do not throw yourselves into destruction. So there's a limit, there's a balance. But he says that there's another form of ibadah as well, and that ibadah is a ibadah which there is no stipulation for, where Allah Azza wa Jalla says, do it abundantly, and that's dhikr. Dhikrullah. Udhkurullaha dhikran kathira. Continue to remember Allah Azza wa Jal and do it often. This is the essence of the Sharia, brothers and sisters. If you look at every single movement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every single teaching, if you study the depth and just avoid the surface for a second and get into the depth of the matter, you'll find that every teaching of his, every moment of his involved the dhikr of Allah. And this is something that Aisha radiallahu anha attested to when she said, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ أَحْيَانِهِ. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would remember Allah Azza wa Jal at all times. This was what he would do, and you would see that. As we walk into the masjid, there's a form of dhikr that should be manifesting on our lips, and of course in the heart. There's a type of dhikr that should be taking place at this time, which is the fact that we are actually making dhikr of dhikr. The hadith that I recited in the beginning, the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, there are no group of individuals that sit together in the house of the houses of Allah and remember Allah Azza wa Jal, except that the malaika descend upon them. The malaika surround them, and sakina and tranquility descends upon them, and Allah Azza wa Jal mentions them. And what a great honor it is that Allah Azza wa Jal will take our name. And that's what's taking place right now. And the proof for this is in the Quran itself. Often we forget that the podium itself for Jummah is not one to speak about current affairs, but rather it is a time to remember Allah. فَسَعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ. It's a time to, he calls, Allah Azza wa Jal calls the khutbah itself, ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ, to remember what you already know. It's not a place necessarily for ta'aleem. It's not a place necessarily to know or learn something new, but it's a time just to recollect what you already know. It's in the Quran, in Surah Al-Jum'ah. فَسَعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. So this is a dhikr that's taking place. And the nature of the dhikr is that the malaika, they surround us, and the rahmah descends upon us, and Allah takes mention of us. One of the benefits of dhikr that Ibn Ata'illah al-Iskandari, rahimahullah, the great saints of the past mentioned, is that when you make dhikr, regardless of whether or not you're actually even paying attention, but the fact that your lips move, or the fact that you listen to the dhikr itself, there are three benefits. The first benefit is that you are actually putting to effect one of the limbs that Allah has created. So you're a dhakir. With dhakirin Allah, right? You fall under the category of a dhakir, someone who remembers Allah. And how many there are, millions and billions, that are not necessarily sharing that quality as you are, the quality of dhikr. So you remember Allah, which is one. The second benefit and the second virtue is that not only are you a dhakir, but you're a madhkur as well. And you're the madhkur, you are the one who is being mentioned with the greatest. The one that you are mentioning, he is mentioning you as well. Allah Azza wa Jal says, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Remember me and I will remember you. So as we speak, he is remembering us. And if you remember him in your heart, then he will remember you within himself. And if you remember him in a gathering, then he will certainly remember you in a gathering far better than the gathering. إِذَا ذَكَرَنِي فِي نَفْسِهِ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي نَفْسِهِ وَإِذَا ذَكَرَنِي فِي مَلَئٍ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي مَلَئٍ خَيْرًا مِّن مَلَئِهِ, which referring to the malaika. So that's the third benefit, he says, that not only does you become a madhkur, not only do you become a madhkur, someone who is mentioned, but someone that is mentioned in an elite gathering. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was passing by a mountain, and he looked at the mountain, and he looked down at the Sahaba, and he said to them, سَبَقَ الْمُفَرِّدُونَ سَبَقَ الْمُفَرِّدُونَ. That's in the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were confused. They knew the language, but they knew that the language of revelation is different than the Arabic language. Subhanallah. So hadith is a reminder for us. It's because you know the Arabic language, or you think you know it, that doesn't mean that you understand revelation. So you use the word mufarridun, and lexically, you can easily look it up in the dictionary. It's not a difficult word to look up, but they knew that the meaning here is something different. Said, Ya Rasulullah, man al-mufarridun? He says, those, al-mufarrid, will be translated here as those who are elect and elite. Those who are elect and elite are the ones who remember Allah Azza wa Jal in abundance. The more that you remember Allah Azza wa Jal, the more He will remember you. Hence, you will be free. You'll be free of any grief. You'll be free from any type of stress. You'll be free from any anxiety. Ala bidhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. Alladhina amanu wa tatma'innu qulubuhum bidhikrillah. Ala bidhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. It's a process. As long as you do it, a type of purification will take place. Even if you are negligent of it. So continue to do it. Even if you think that you're not feeling anything, according to Ibn Ata'illah, even if you don't feel like you're doing anything, it's still better than not doing it at all. Continue to do it until you actually are remembering him. And as you remember him, he remembers you. And then there's nothing to worry, there's nothing to fear. The greatest form of dhikr, أفضل الذكر لا إله إلا الله. لا إله إلا الله. This is a dhikr. It's prescribed from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The greatest form of dhikr for all of us to begin with is La ilaha illallah. There is nothing worthy of worship except for Allah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. So let this become a habit, inshallah. Continuously do tahleel. It's the greatest form of dhikr. Inshallah, the cleansing will take place, and then the reality will soon make itself apparent to us. الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا. So the process As a cleansing takes place, whether you're sitting or you're standing, there's no limit to it. As long as it's happening, a purification will be taking place, and when the heart becomes clean, then the wahi starts making sense. And the signs, both the signs that are apparent in text and the signs of the cosmos, start making a lot more sense. And inshallah, we will be able to get through the great test of the dunya. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give us tawfiq and allow us to benefit from whatever was said and allow the dhikr to truly penetrate our hearts. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. Perform sunnah inshallah.